Good morning. God bless you. Good to see all of you here today. Welcome to Dade City First United Methodist Church. I'm Robert Roseberry, pastor here at this community of faith. And if you're new to our church this morning, we're glad that you chose to worship with us. We have a guest information card on the table back in the narthex in the entryway as you came in. We'd love to get to know you a little bit better. So we appreciate you filling those out. And when you get a chance, if you didn't get a guest card when you came in, please raise your hand, let one of our greeters know, and we'll be happy to get one to you. And you can put that card in the offering plate after you're done with it later on in the service. There are some announcements in your weekly update. There are a lot of things coming up in August and September, but let me go over a few of the things we've got going on that are coming up soon. I'm going to skip some and highlight some. I apologize if I skip your favorite event, but I just want to make sure to highlight some stuff so you know what they are. We've got a really fun youth event coming up this evening. We'll be going to Disney to watch fireworks and do some spiritual preparation for the new school year. They do go together, and we're going to have a fun evening, summer night out this evening. I also want to let everyone know that July is a fifth Sunday month. It's a month when we ask for a special offering for the Florida United Methodist Children's Home. It's a connectional ministry that we do together with the other churches in the Florida Annual Conference. And above and beyond your regular giving, that's a second mile gift. We would appreciate any kind of extra support you could give to the Florida United Methodist Children's Home. It's a wonderful ministry, and we're happy to be a part of it. We do have a lot of things, like I said, coming up in August. Wednesday, August the 2nd, immediately following our church family dinner, is going to be a fun, informal event for our whole congregation to make some joyful noise together. We'll be singing well-known, easy-to-learn Christian music, or traditional and contemporary, both. If you happen to have an instrument, feel free to bring it. And even if you have, and that's any instrument, by the way. Susan assured me, any instrument. I even said washboard in the 9 o'clock service. And that's okay, too. And even if the instruments are attached to the bottom of your shoes, that's okay, too. Just is a fun, kind of casual time to make some music together. And we hope that you'll come. It's just, you used to call them jam sessions. It's just a time of music, hymn sing, whatever you want to call it. It's just going to be a fun time. If you have any songs or hymn requests, please send them to Susan by the 26th. And you've got her email address there in the weekly update, and hope you'll be a part of that. It's going to be a fun, relaxed time. That's August the 2nd, right after the church family dinner. So you can come to dinner, and the entertainment will be provided by everyone. We also have a ministry fair on the 20th of August. Church Council is looking to get ministries and committees going again, get some stuff bubbling up, and we need your help to make our ministries run and also to start new ones. The church works by the people. And so we're hoping to continue our recovery after COVID and get some things going again. So after each of the two services, we're going to have a little expo set up in the CLC so that you can meet the people or the ministries here at the church. Some of the people, some of the ministries have people. Some of them we hope to have people. And so that's where you all come in. And we hope that you'll help us increase our ministry footprint. And if you don't have something that you see that you feel called to be a part of, we're open, the church council is open to starting some new ministries. This is a time of, you know, new ideas. Some things will be historical from this point on, and some things we might start up new and be an interesting new thing that we do together. So we hope that you'll join us in that. That's August the 20th, so plan to stay a little bit later after church. We'll have a little tiny refreshments, but we won't be serving a lunch. But we do hope that you'll come and be a part of that. Our first hymn is number 368, My Hope is Built. Would you please stand as you're able as we sing this hymn together? We'll sing verses 1 through 3.
I rest on His unchanging grace.
seated. So Matthew 13 is, as we've already discovered, chock full of good parables. These parables give us food for thought about what God's kingdom will be like. Jesus doesn't explain all of them, but the kingdom we know is not an earthly kingdom with territory and bureaucrats and offices. No, it's a kingdom that we hold in our souls, in our minds, and in our hearts, and that's made manifest in our actions as we love our neighbor like God has loved us. We are citizens of this kingdom not because we hold papers or a passport or a birth certificate, but because we hold our primary allegiance to Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And Jesus' story of the weed and the wheat, weeds and the wheat tell us that we may appear that what may appear to be a lost cause isn't necessarily lost to grace. So today, let our prayers overflow for our own healing, but also for the healing of the world. We might be, no, we are, continually surprised at the way that God's grace manifests itself among us. We never know who we might see shining like the sun. And these last several weeks, we've learned to imagine a new reality where even flawed humans like ourselves can be disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. So let this week be an invitation to let God's Spirit fill your soul and Christ's love to fill your heart. We would be honored to be a part of that journey, of your journey with Christ, no matter where you're starting from. And there's no better time to start than today. So we invite you to take your weekly update and prayer list that's there on the weekly update. Take that home with you. Pray for these names throughout the week, whether you know them or not. It is important that we all pray for these prayer requests. And I know these people would love every single prayer that they can get. If you'd like to submit a prayer request to us, there's a gray two-sided prayer request card on the entryway table. Didn't mean for that to sound so ominous, but the thunder is helping. You can fill that out, put it in the offering plate, or you can also email the church office. So as we enter our time of prayer this morning, let's hear from Romans chapter 8, verses 26 to 39. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. Let us pray. Creator God, Holy Gardener, who sustains and nurtures all life, open us today to your life-giving grace and transformative love. As we notice our internal struggles, empower us to greet the wheat and the weeds in our own hearts with care and compassion. As we recognize the challenges and suffering in our community, inspire us to meet the weeds and the wheat in our neighbors with acceptance and hope. We know that you alone have the final say, and so we give ourselves over to you as instruments of hospitality and grace that we would tend our neighbors even as we are tended by you. We pray this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our next hymn is number 474 in your hymnals, which is the blue book in front of you. It's Precious Lord, Take My Hand. Would you please stand as you're able, and let's sing this hymn together.
Precious Lord. My head.
join me in prayer for our morning offering. Holy God, we live in days of division and polarization, and we regretfully confess that your church is not exempt from that statement. Regardless of where we stand, it is far too easy to look at those who see things differently and see them as weeds, stunting the good fruit we could bear. But as we bring our offerings to you, the temptation to focus on our own agenda is strong. Lord, help us to give generously without judging. Give us the faith to put these gifts to your use and humility to know that only you can see clearly what is wheat and what is weed. We pray in the name of Christ, who knows all hearts. Amen. Be seated. Our scripture reading for today, is from Matthew 13, verses 24 to 30 and 36 to 43. It's a beautiful segue to the scripture reading today. And Matthew 13 is sometimes called the parable chapter. This is yet another parable that Jesus speaks, and then he will explain it in verses 36 to 43. So we are skipping a section of chapter 13 as we read this parable and then the explanation. So Jesus put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field. But while everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from? And he answered, An enemy has done this. The slave said to him, Then do you want us to go and gather them? But he replied, No, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest. And at the harvest time, I will tell the reapers, Collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat in my barn. Then he left the crowds and went into the house. And his disciples approached him, saying, Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field. And Jesus answered, The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all evildoers, and they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone with ears listen. The word of God for the people of God. Praise be to God. Oftentimes, not a whole bunch, but oftentimes, I don't know where it falls between often and a whole lot, but occasionally there is a thing that happens in a church family that irritates somebody. I know that never happens here. But, and sometimes if they get irritated enough, they will come to the pastor's office and won't talk about it. And this happened to me one time. There was a thing that had happened in our congregation and with a certain family in our congregation, and sitting behind them on the pew, this was a different church, not this one. Just want to make that clear. Y'all don't think I'm telling tales. I'm telling tales on people from another church, so that's okay. But they came to my office, and they were very, very worried at what had happened with this family that sits directly in front of them. They were worried about their daughter that they had being exposed to this. They were extremely afraid, and the wife especially was super, just she was boiling over with frustration and anger and worry and fear, just really had fear all over her face. And I remember at one point in our conversation, it was very apparent that she wanted to get away from people like this. And she said, I just want to move to the mountains where everybody will be all right. No, where people will just be different. It's going to be more relaxed, and I won't have to deal with this. And at that point, I couldn't help myself. I said, do you really think that folks are going to be that different? You don't think there's any bad folks somewhere out there different than here? Sometimes people like to get away from other people's prying eyes and do what they're going to do. And that's why they move out there. She didn't like that. But what was interesting to me is that a few years later, that family would be torn apart by adultery. She would be the offending party and would tear her family up. And her desire to be morally pure and free was blinding her to the weeds in her own life. The world is full of weeds, whether we like it or not. They're in every place. They're growing in every field. They're here, they're there, they're everywhere. And those weeds are sown by the enemy of Christ, the devil, Satan, whatever you want to name it. But the world is also full of wheat. God sprinkles the wheat around too, and that grows up and produces a wonderful kingdom kind of fruit. There is good in the world too. And they always grow together. Sometimes it's also hard to tell what a weed is. We think it's easy, but when you really get down to it, especially those of you, if you garden, it can be hard to tell what a weed is sometimes. Sometimes you don't know until it grows up a little bit. You might pull up something that you might want later, especially if you love plants like I do, and I know a lot of you do. It hurts you to pull a weed because you think that might be pretty later on. and you don't know. I remember in our last parsonage, there was a row of beautiful flowers that I almost missed out on because I was going to pull each and every one of those weeds. And instead I said, I want to see what these are. And within a couple of weeks, they were beautiful. And I'm glad I didn't pull them because they had sat dormant for a whole year and a half since I had planted them. And then just decided to spring up and bless the world with their appearance. I would have thought that they were weeds. Jesus might have been telling this parable to differentiate himself from the religious movements around him. You might know that the kind of three-party system that they had in Judaism during that day. You may not, but here's basically what they were. You had, you know, Roman occupation was over the Jewish people. And the Pharisees were a lay renewal movement within Judaism. They were very strict on following the law, making sure that the Torah was obeyed, and they believed that God would lead them through this time of occupation if they just kept following the law. And so they did cooperate with the Romans, and they tried to maintain a balance of their independence underneath Roman oppression that would be doable. They could be accused of being legalistic, but that was where they were, and they believed that was the way God was calling God's people to be. Then you had the Sadducees, which were a little bit different, had some different doctrinal beliefs, and they also cooperated and stood some independence from the Romans. And then you had the Essenes. And the Essenes were very much a purity movement within Judaism. And the Essenes thought that the best way they could follow God was to get the heck out of Dodge. You may have heard of the Dead Sea Scrolls of Qumran, and that was one of their communities. And they thought that if they could just get away, that life would be perfect. And they formed a celibate religious community within the desert of Judea. And that is where they lived. Many people think that John the Baptizer might have been an Essene. And at this point in the story of Matthew's gospel, people are still wondering sort of, where does Jesus fall? And as he tells this story, you can be sure he does not fall with the Essenes. But Christian churches have also struggled with this tension. Some churches want to be a part of the world and transform it from within. Some churches want to be apart from the world and transform it from the outside. And some want to get way the heck out and be completely separate and have nothing to do with anybody that might be a weed. And purity movements generally can be very, very toxic. We know this from our own history here in the South. Ethnic and racial movements that try to bestow some sort of purity on society to make it into somewhat of a utopia never end up working well. They end up harming and not helping. Also, doctrinal purity movements within Christianity have never really worked all that well. Separatist movements are separate, but they've never really transformed, even despite their gracious and lofty goals, have never transformed the world from the way outside. This is also our history, too, in the Christian church. We want to be judge and jury, but we have a terrible history and a terrible record of success. If you and I had walked into this church 100 years ago and been okay with racial integration here at First United Methodist Church of Dade City, everyone would have thought that we were weeds and not the wheat. But through that, even though there's a weedy past in every Southern church, most of us have that history, even so, those folks who had weedy tendencies, we can say, even then, those people who built this church and created this community created a space where we can be nurtured, where we can be spiritually fed, and where we can grow in Christ. The weeds and the wheat do go together. There is no separating them. We can judge them from our standpoint in history, but in reality, we need to also look at the good that happened. Weeds and wheat are all mixed up together. There is no perfect church, and if you ever find one, don't join it because you'll ruin it. Just worship outside the doors. There is no perfect church. We are all mixed up together. We want to think in black and white, but often there is a whole bunch of gray in between. So how do we deal with that? How do we deal with evil? How do we deal with these children of the weeds that we see growing up, the weeds that are sown among us? How do we deal with that? Is it just complacency? Is this what Jesus is advocating here? Just, hey, let them grow up together, it'll be fine. Well, we do know a few things in the parable. We know that the field hands don't have the ability, per the master's instructions, to get rid of all the weeds. When we try, the results are often disastrous. We'll pull up the wheat along with the weeds. And by the way, the word for weeds, I do want to make note, the word for weeds is a word for a plant in the Middle East that was very similar to wheat. Think of it like a false wheat. And often you would find it growing wild, and you might think it's wheat until you get up close to it. And so the master knows that in pulling up this plant, you might accidentally pull up a good one too. We live in that kind of an imperfect world. And we live as obediently and as faithful to the gospel as possible. But we do know one thing, that the harvest is sure and those children of the kingdom will shine like the sun, we're told in this passage. So what is the best solution? Well, maybe, like God, we should have grace with each other. Because God's grace is showered on each and every one of us. We may think it might go more for some people than others, but it really isn't. There's a whole lot of grace given to each one of us. God doesn't give it to us with a measuring cup. God showers his grace on all of us. And so maybe the best solution is to give grace to each other too, to love each other, to care for each other, to look out for each other's well-being. And that may mean sometimes taking a stand against the weeds that encroach, but it also means that we draw lines carefully, with humility and peace for all. We make sure that in drawing those lines, we don't become children of the devil ourselves, that we don't become the weeds too. Because we may look at a room and think it's full of weeds, but in fact, they're all just like us. Instead, maybe we let God do the judging. In spite of our deepest instincts and the pull that we feel, maybe we should let God do that judging. Let him be the one who sets the lines. Because often, when we look back on moments in history, we are surprised at who is shining like the sun. In the moment, we might have thought that it was terrible, that it was a moment full of weeds, that that person was a child, that it was a weed growing in the garden. But looking back, we realize that they're actually children of the kingdom. And I think through that, through a common grace and a common love and a common care for each other, God will help us shine like the sun. Let us pray. Dear Lord, it is hard to know how to deal with the weeds. It's hard to know the wisdom that you would have us have. But Lord, ultimately, we lay the cares at your feet, for you are the good gardener who sees the weeds and the wheat for what they are and can see them more clearly than we can. Lord, help us be people of humble grace, people who pray and love first and leave the rest up to you. Amen. In your hymnals on page 881, there is the Apostles' Creed with which we'll affirm our common faith. Would you please rise as you're able? As we recite the words of the Apostles' Creed to remember our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we end our service today, would you please sing our next hymn, number 700 in your hymnals, Abide With Me. Bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace this day and forevermore. Amen.